Francisco Javier Saverón is currently General Director of the National Institute of Genomic Medicine and a Senior Research Scientist of the Biotechnology Institute of UNAM, the National University of Mexico. He holds a PhD in biomedical research from UNAM. His research has focused on the chemical synthesis of DNA and its applications in the study of proteins, as well as the development of biopharmaceutical and vaccines and biocatalysis. More recently, he has focused on genomics and its applications to human health. He has published more than 70 original research articles in journals of international circulation. Start, please.
Thank you. Well, I'm very glad to be here. I enjoy very much the opportunity to speak to people from different approaches to knowledge, and especially being in an environment where there's academic research of from different perspectives, it's particularly attractive for me. And I'm also very enthusiastic about what's happening in the area of the biological sciences, and especially this buzzword that is genomics, which is genetics of the 21st century, let's say. And I will try to do a little bit of explaining why is it that genomics is becoming a useful tool for studying many things, including human behavior. So I will refer to basically all the concepts that are listed there, not necessarily in a particular order. I will go a little back and forth. But I will speak about the genomics revolution, the relationship of genes and human emotions, and in general about the biological basis of emotional behavior. So I will start with some basic tenets, at least are basic tenets for me, maybe from some of you as well. The first one is this phrase that is known from other contexts, and a molecular biologist Nobel Prize says when referring to the nervous system, he says, no matter, never mind. And it's clear that the mind today is understood as something that has a biological basis and a biological manifestation. It's in the neurons, right? So, And I quoted this. I also brought this from a neurosurgeon. It says the idea that my tool is moving through thought itself, through emotion and reason, that memories, dreams, and reflections should consist of jelly, is simply too strange to understand. Nevertheless, it is a fact. The other tenet is humans are a product of evolution. We are here due to a process. And of course, Darwin, facing some trouble probably, stated that in one of his books, After the Origin of the Species. And I think the last part is what I want to emphasize. Man still bears in his bodily frame the indelible stamp of his lowly origin. So, we are a product of evolution. That's a basic tenet also. And this one is probably a little bit more, I guess, I don't know if it's less obvious, but sometimes I find it not as shared as an idea. That is, a human brain is a direct product of a human genome. A human genome produces a human brain. And it's different from a chimp's brain, and it's different from a rat brain. And it's already, since birth and before, it is already a human brain. So it's biologically predisposed. It has some inherent capabilities and inherent tendencies to operate in a particular manner. And that's also a product of evolution, of course. But then we can understand, and the human brain is determined by the human genome. The structure, the basic structure of the brain, it is a product, a direct product of the manifestation of the genes. It hasn't, it hasn't been influenced, maybe in a very subtle and marginal way, but basically it's a product of genes. So we can understand much of what it, how it works by understanding the genetic code that produces it. Yes? Well, the human brain itself, the way it is being formed in the womb starts to receive some environmental cues. Of course, that I understand if that's what you're saying, and of course, immediately afterwards, and especially after birth, it starts receiving a lot of content and it starts accommodating a lot of content, but that it requires to be a human brain, and it already is a human brain because of the genes that instructed the cells to produce that. That's what I'm trying to say. Not. I'm not, of course, saying that there is the environment has nothing to do. Of course, that's most of what we are is a product of the environment. Of course. So this is another. It's not a basic tenet. It's just. That we know some things about the basic, some even strange things about emotions from natural experiments. This one very famous is this accident that happened to this person, Phineas or Phineas Gage, that received this steel bar across his brain, and he raised from the accident on his own and started speaking again, and it seemed fairly normal. And actually, after some time, it was determined that his faculties were basically not much perturbed, but he lost all control of emotions and became he was the foreman of the crew, and he became completely socially unadapted because of the perturbance of that part of his brain, which is more related. It has been seen with planning, moral judgment, and emotional control. So, of course, there is evidence that certain areas of the brain are directly related with emotional responses. This one, I read this in Time magazine maybe 30 years ago, talking about the neurosurgeons. But this I remember it very well. This stockbroker who lost his successful judgment after brain surgery, and all the faculties intact, intelligence and number capability and reading ability, everything, except he no longer felt fear or when entertaining risky transactions. And he became a failure just because his emotions were not in tune with his activity. And I found that extremely, extremely interesting. Well, I think none of that what I said is new. No, everybody knows that, or to some extent. I think it's relatively easy to be more or less in agreement with some of those tenets or concepts. But what is new that I want to bring here today is that now genes are accessible. When genes were fairly inaccessible, very indirectly, we could get to them. But by virtue of the genomics revolution that started in the last decade of last century and has started with a very, very impetuous pace in this century, we now have access to the genes. Why is that? Well, just a few things to say. From the discovery of the double helix, from the discovery that the material that of heredity is a chemical strand which has a code with four chemical letters, to the possibility of starting the study of a whole genome of a human, 60 years elapsed, And this is what we call especially the molecular biology era, and then the recombinant DNA at the end of the century. But then the scientific community there start to think about sequencing or obtaining the code of the whole genome. This was unthinkable even in 1985 when I learned for the first time we're planning to do it. And I thought it was completely nuts, impossible, because of the power at that time. Well, I can't resist but saying that I did the first DNA sequencing that was done in this country, 1979, and it took me about 3 months of hard work to sequence 150 letters from my genetic system. And then I was told 10 years later, or less than 10 years later, that they were going to try to sequence 3.2 billion letters. How was that going to be possible? Well, in fact, it was possible. Technology advanced. And then in the last 15 years, front pages of the journal Nature, which featured a particular genomic advance, and there are many different areas where it started, where it impacted having human genome. This has come to a situation right now that is, I think, really astonishing. This here is the very well-known Moore's law of the advance or the progress of computing power per unit of cost, and this is of course it's exponential or logarithmic scale, and this was the cost of sequencing genomes or sequencing DNA, the basic technology for genetics, and this is what happened about the middle of the past decade, about 2006, 2007. And it was a major, major technological advance. And so we have now a technology that has dropped in cost a million times from the time that the human genome was first deciphered. So nothing in the history of mankind, no technology has dropped in price as dramatically as this one. It used to be a time when we measure one letter at a time in an experimental system, and now we have these chips which can measure 5 million in a few minutes, 5 million positions of a genome in just a few minutes with very, very highly reliable results. And that's why the first genome cost $3.2 billion, around a dollar a base, and then at this time, we are in $1,000 per genome, per new genome. If any one of us wants to make decipher his own genome or her own genome, will cost $1,000. And we are approaching the point where we will have a million human genomes sequenced around the world. So we have access to amounts of data that were unimaginable just a few years ago. So that's what the genomic technology has advanced. And it opens several possibilities. One of them relates to the evolution of the human species. Genomics opens a history book. So we now have, I think, mainly because of the genomic comparisons of the genomes of all these species and many others, we are, I think it's firmly established that the divergence from the orangutan happened in the common ancestor of humans about 14 million years ago, with a gorilla about 8 or so, and with the chimpanzee it's about 5 to 7 million years. We know there are two types of chimpanzees, 2.5 million years. Between one of them, between the two varieties of chimpanzees, which are our closest cousins, extant cousins, of course, and the human related to all of them. And there are Of course, what we now distinguish hominids, these are all hominids, from hominins, which are the ones that are after the chimpanzee. So the evolution of these is mainly on the fossil record, because our closest cousin is the chimpanzee. But we know from the fossil record, and now we know from other sources several of these intermediate varieties of hominins. Okay, the earliest until the Australopithecines, and check here up until 3 million years ago is about when the bipedalism started, and several other things were happening. And Homo is about 1 million years or so. These are between 1 and 2 million years ago. So, but now we have a possibility to access these dates, because we can check the differences in mutations of individuals that we sequence today. And then we make counts and we take the biological clock or the genetic clock, and we see so many mutations imply so many years or so many millennia or so many million years. And further, we have been starting, scientific community has been able to sequence ancient DNA, DNA that has been fossilized. I think one of the most amazing possibilities is to sequence DNA from hundreds of thousands of years ago. And we have now the complete genome of several Neanderthals. Okay? And these are taken from remains of the bones. This one is really interesting, I think. This is the piece of bone that was used to find not a Neanderthal and not modern human, but also living in Europe, which is called the Denisova, because it was found in a cave. And because we were able to sequence the DNA, we know that it's not a Neanderthal, it's not a modern human. And we also know that some of the genes of that species or that subspecies is present today in some populations in the world, especially in South Asia, only there. But we don't have a skeleton for this species. What we already know, it was not a Neanderthal, not a modern human. So that's what has been possible to do with the new technologies of DNA sequencing. As you can see here, we know this is some biological group, okay, coming from several million years ago, separated about 600,000 years ago. From the Neanderthals, and then the Denisovans separated from them. And all this we know because we can access their DNA. Lots of the DNA. In one case, the whole genome. Well, so we can now take a look at human evolution from a completely different perspective, because we have access to all those data. Now, about a little bit about how we understand emotions, or the way I understand emotions, being just a natural scientist. In its relationship with the brain, so we know that basically there is a subset of the brain that is more specialized in housing emotions, although everything is communicated. We have this limbic system that we share with other species that are, similar to us, mammals and primates. And there's other parts of the brain that are much more primeval, much more related, shared with species that have diverged lots of time ago. And then the cortex, or the neocortex, that is probably was present certainly in some of the other, like the Neanderthals or the Denisovans, but not in other mammals, and not in the same way in the chimpanzees, for instance. So I think that's why being in emotions from that perspective has, given good health to this particular approach that is called evolutionary psychology, I find it really interesting. For instance, some new things that are being happening from the biological perspective is recognition of this concept of evolutionary linguistics. So trying to understand that language is something that also evolved, and it evolved with some of the human and pre-human lineages. How it did, it was not a valiant endeavor until the very early, I mean very recently, I learned. And also the importance of the control of fire is probably over a million years ago that humans started controlling fire. And that changed completely their social relationships and started to also to mark some differences between the behavior of males and females. And it's there. Of course, it modified completely our digestive system. But there are signals of that progress, of that evolution of a million years, which is a significant time, which has been marked in the genes. Well, it's interesting, again, that Charles Darwin said this in the Origin of Species. He said the discovery of fire, probably the greatest ever made by man, excepting language, dates from before the dawn of history. So we, according to this view, we are beings that have been modeled by evolution for sufficiently long time to distinguish these effects in our social and emotional behavior. And that's not possible. It is possible now to start to dismember it and to analyze it more systematically. The other thing I want to convey to you is I think it's very, very interesting, very useful to see that evolutionarily, humans have been in what we call the cognitive niche. I think it's a useful concept. The cognitive niche, look, what says is that humans have created a new biological niche. And that niche is a place where humans that become more intelligent and more socially functional leave more descendants. And so that's why this niche, it didn't exist. It was even created by human societies. And so that's the context where we should look at to understand how human evolution works. Technology is there for over a million years or more. So this technology is where humans have to thrive. Using technology, the individual that doesn't learn how to use technology will die. So that's sort of the idea. Of course, having language, it's very important for survival to be able to use language. So there are pressures to maintain and even to enhance linguistic capabilities in these populations that were evolving. And other things like cooperation among non-kin, very human, and very related to emotions. These are things that evolved in these environments. Other human characteristics are there. Of course, human division into cultures, the different language, customs, diets, depends extremely importantly in cultural or learned information. What I'm saying is there is a substrate that is amenable for study that is in there, and we shouldn't ignore it. I think it's extremely, I think it will be extremely capable of explaining much of what we humans are. It does relate to particular genes. We are now starting to be able to discover which genes are doing what. Some of them are, I think it's very, very interesting to look at. This one I like, this FOXP2 mutation, pronounced in Spanish. It sounds even more provocative. but it's related to language. And the mutation it is possible to say that there is a mutation there that has adapted value. Technically, we can say it because of the nature of the mutation. And so we know that there is a mutation that was fixed in there, and it promotes a better use. So we know it's related to language because families which have the mutations in that gene are impaired in their language abilities. And we also have been able to start testing it. If you give a mouse the human version of FOXP2, you will have a mouse that cries differently, and also a mouse that has some interesting nervous system development, which changes. This is a control gene. It's a gene that controls several functions, and its function in the brain is, of course, not very well understood, but it has relationship with communication and language. A similar one is this. I will talk a little bit more about that one. That this SRGAP2 gene, a duplicated in hominins, not in the other hominins. So we can start mapping some genes and some functions to particular moments in evolution, because we can check which of our related species have the versions or not have the versions. I will do propose a few more examples. So you see here some of the behavioral and cultural characteristics and the relationship that they may have with particular emergence of gene variations. Okay. For instance, we know that Neanderthals already had this FOXP2 mutation. One thing I found astonishing is that in the mainstream of the linguist community, they assume that the language is something that emerged about 70 to 100,000 years ago. Genetically, that's absolutely untenable. It has to have evolved at least 250,000 years ago, which is the last common ancestor of all humans that live today. And every human is capable of acquiring language indistinguishable from every other language. You know, unless it's sick, but that's not a population related. But these things we learned just recently. So we know that fact we know because of recent finding. A few examples, I think very, very provocative, at least for me. This gene, it is certainly involved in nervous system development, brain development, and chimps and orangutans have only one copy. Every human being has between 4 and 6 copies, and not all have the same number of copies. It's something to think about. Okay, this is very, very likely related to the events that were at the very start of the hominin lineage. We now know other things. This is another very interesting gene. It is also a control gene called HER5. The human version, you give it to a mouse, and then you get expression at some time in development. So this is the chimp version. And then if you give the human version, it starts producing its products earlier, and it promotes a larger brain. Okay, and this version is different from the other hominids. So we now have a few candidates for the crucial differences. So we know we are different from a chimpanzee on average about 30 million positions of the genome. We are different from each other about 3.5 million positions. And we are 10 times as different from a chimpanzee. So which of those 30 million modifications are important? Seems hard, and it is hard, but it's becoming more and more amenable to study. It's also maybe some of you are questioning, how can we make a mouse with a human gene? And we can do that now fairly, in a fairly standard way. So we can modify and give those genes and experiment in some of these animal models very well. We cannot do it with humans, of course. And this is another, coming to the conclusion, the hominin lineage, it's very interesting and it's very different in some regards, that they pertain to the dynamics of the genome. It turns out that our genome, each bar here represents one of our chromosomes, so we have the sequence of all of it, and we know that there are many repetitive positions in there, remains of viruses and other things like that, and it turns out that that promotes that recombination between some parts of the genome and others occur much more frequently than even in other hominids. Okay? We recombine our genome, our lineage recombines the genome more often than the chimp and the gorilla, which is fairly surprising because we are so close. So it seems that part of human evolution, it's has been the result of a particular dynamics. And it turns out as well that some of the psychiatric diseases occur frequently because of this of these dynamics. So it seems that our genome has been a producer of diversity related to the nervous system and to the brain, at the cost of producing people that are mentally ill. That's a very, very, I would say, scary concept, and it's still preliminary, but I think it has some data supporting it. Okay, so behavioral traits and the appearance of mental illness seem to be related, because our genome is inventive in creating brain modifications. Okay. I don't know if this was too technical. I hope I made clear what the implications are. Now, of course, now there are other genes, you know, not necessarily from an evolutionary perspective, but directly related to emotions. And we know that there are several products of those genes that are clearly related to emotions: dopamine, oxytocin, vasopressin, serotonin. These peptides are some other substances that are clearly related to certain areas of the brain, and they turn on and off, and they operate in the nervous system in different moments, and of course reacting to cues from the environment. And I will cite some of the ones that are the studies that I find more provocative. For instance, we know oxytocin. This is the hormone of empathy, the hormone of, let's say, in certain way it could be called the hormone of love. Oxytocin in the brain creates reactions that are very strong. In the case of rats, it has been studied, and this is very nice because it shows how a pre-existing network of interactions reacts to an environmental cue. In this case, the pups crying. When the pups cry, they turn on oxytocin in certain areas of the rat's brain, and then the mother becomes a mom. Says like, so now it turns on the behavior to take care of the pups. So there is that gene product oxytocin that is related to behavior, that is related also to emotions. This is the one that I find most provocative. This FOSB gene, which is related with nurturing, when there's mutations in this gene in the female, they are absolutely normal mice. in every regard, except after they give birth. After they give birth, they just don't start the nurturing behavior. And then when we check the brains of those rats, it never turns on the program in the neurons. And that's why these are bad mothers. This is their only defect. They are bad mothers. Now, the question, this very, I think it's an obligatory question. Do we have a FOSB? Or do we humans have FOSB? Does it do the same? Well, nobody has dared study that. But we could. We certainly could check what is the different versions of FOSB and if they are related to particular behaviors after birth in women. It could be studied. It hasn't been done. I've been checking the literature repeatedly. Now I will resort to talking with the postdoc that did this 20 years ago. But nobody has studied that yet. But of course, I have to refer here to the other enormously important component that we can study by studying genes, and that's epigenetic signals. The signals that come on top of the genes and that are a reflection of the history of those cells, of those individuals, and that become imprinted in the structure of the genome, but not in the code. Okay? It's like the chapter of a book. The chapter is identical, but I have a clip and I have it silent. Nobody can read it. Or I have the book open already and I pass along the book already open in particular chapters on particular places. So it's just turning on or off certain parts of the genome on a stable basis. Okay? And it can even skip a generation or two. Some of these signals. And these signals, some of the best characterized also in rats, is related also to mothering, but also to the effects of good mothering or bad mothering. It says good mothering in there. It seems that Mexican mothers don't do too much. Here, and this is the neglecting mother. Okay? There's ways to make rats behave that way. But then when you study the genes, you know, you can very clearly and repeatedly, it's very, very well established fact that when maternal care is high, you generate an active receptor for glucocorticoids, which are the stress hormones. And then these genes remain active for the life of the rat. Whereas when there is neglect, these genes turn off and remain off for the remainder of the life of that pup. So this is an epigenetic effect, which is durable, is not inheritable. So these, when they become mothers, they will reset the state of a gene. But it didn't change the code. It only turned it off. But the effect is very important in the future of the pup. We suspect that this is very much similar in humans and that much of experiences, especially early experiences or prenatal experiences, are imprinted in our genomes. And that's a whole other dimension, even at the genetic level, the epigenetic level. Of course, needless to say, all the other effects, social, cultural, educational, and so on, which are dominant in the human as a species. Now, how do we study that in humans? We cannot make humans knock out the genes. We cannot, open their brains when they're alive and see. Well, we can use imaging technologies like the ones that were already described and are becoming more and more useful. But we can also do these types of studies, what we call genome-wide association studies. You take a set of individuals, could be humans, which have a certain characteristic. You try to isolate that, as a variable, and then check their genotype or their genomes. And then take another set, which is different. Let's say, for the sake of my previous imagine experiment, mothers that abandon their children and mothers that are just normal mothers. And then you scan the whole genome, the 3.2 billion bases, and say, in which positions they are statistically different. And that pinpoints where a gene that is related to that particular trait is located. And we can do that, especially now that we have a million genomes, that we can spend $100 and then have the genotype of any person. We can do these studies at our heart's content. It's just a matter of imagining the experiments and the studies, you know, and of course obtaining the informed consent of the individuals. And the other is candidate gene analysis, inspired by animal and other type of studies. So we can do that as well. So it is open for study. Some of the recent discoveries are, I think, very thought-provoking. Genes related to aggressiveness, very, very strongly related to aggressiveness. And in this case of the monoamino oxidase, we know also the epigenetic component. Certain mutations generate almost always very aggressive people. 90% of them go to jail. And some versions of this same gene make people prone to aggressiveness, but a more favorable environment makes them the manifestation of that version of the gene is much lighter. And so there are many others. I like this one, very recent, the genetic basis of music ability. That's very related to emotions. And there are some genes and some areas of the genome that are related to that. And this is last week, genome-wide association study of loneliness. So they relate some genes with people that feel lonely, and there's a signal. By the way, this signal here, this is log P, so it's very significant. Not necessarily has a strong effect, but undoubtedly influences that trait. That is very sure. In this case, loneliness is just genes related to loneliness, but not much more. It could be very small effect. Just to end up, this is oxytocin methylation as measured in saliva, and display and makes it possible to differentiate some more secure attachment style from others, and its capacity to recognize emotional facial expressions, depending on the variety of the gene that the people inherited. And so, to me, this perspective is a few genes have been studied today, but the new capacities of the technology, it really opened the possibility of studying many, many, many more. And that's not to say that we will be able to explain by genetics a lot of human behavior. Only a fraction of human behavior will be related more directly to genes. But that fraction I find fascinating. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The discussion is open.
The difference between genomic in humans and chimpanzees makes some useless the study and homology between cognition and behavior in, for example, bonobos and human, with the goal to explain moral or empathy or cooperation?
Of course, I ponder this question as well. If you see the times of divergence, so in 2.5 million years, bonobos and you know, regular chimpanzees, I don't know how to call them, Pampaniscus and the other, Pantroglodytes is the name, very apt name for the one that is more aggressive. You know, their behavior, their sexual behavior is completely different. It's only 2.5 million years. And so if you see that, you say, well, what is the relevance of their behavior to ours? 6 million years divergence. I still think that we can learn, if we are wise enough, we can learn even from rats or from bees or ants. We can learn, only we have to be sufficiently, you know, clear in our hypothesis on what is translatable or not. But I think the caution that you, I understand in your question, I would agree with it. We have to be very cautious as to what is the implications of the behaviors of some of these species that are close to us.
Okay. Thanks very much for the talk. I certainly share the enthusiasm for this amazing science of genomics. I was a little concerned that in the talk you sometimes presented some of the particular genes you talked about, a neurotransmitter in one case, as if they had a single impact. And you used that language. FOSB, you said, only causes maternal deficits.
I may have implied it, but I didn't say it.
You actually said it. Just correction for the... Just to make sure everyone is clear, other studies show that it causes depressive behavior. It also causes epilepsy and some neurodegenesis. So it
in rats?
In mice.
In mice, I'm sorry. Uh-huh.
FOXP2, as you mentioned, is found in other mammals. It's also found in fish. I mean, the idea that it's a language gene has been popularized by the press, but people in your field, as you know, it's contributing something to language, but exactly what is a bit unclear. Mm-hmm. Oxytocin has been implicated in a number of social behaviors, but also in aggression. And its actual impact on emotion is, again, going to be quite varied and complex in ways that we don't fully understand. MAOA, maybe I don't know the new work that you mentioned with the 90%, but the original work on MOMA, I think, was really very effectively criticized. It's found in 30% of men. Its contribution to violence seems to depend on environmental factors. Mm-hmm. So I think you did, you know, hedge and make this clear in some points, but I just want to make sure and maybe to ask you whether sometimes the telling of the story gives the impression that there's a gene for a specific behavior. So maybe a direct way to ask you would be to say, do you think that there's any evidence that there's a gene for something behavioral? Yeah.
No, of course, I think you're absolutely right. And I'm very glad that you made the distinction. Every gene manifestation is what we call epistatic, okay? So genes don't only do one thing. Most of the genes do different things. They participate in different processes. And it's only in some instances and some versions of the genes that have what we call high penetrance. I will barely touch a little bit in a few of the things that you pointed out. First, in the case of the mouse, this knockout, it is, I did say that it was normal in every other regard, of course. I haven't taken it to the theater. I don't know exactly how it will react there. I don't know if it's already a phrase of cats or no longer. So there are many, many things that we didn't try, or they didn't try. Okay? In the cage, you know, in the obvious behavior, and that's part of a story. You know, the postdoc thought that knockout was of no consequence whatsoever. It was of no consequence at the level of her studies. Of course, FOSB expresses in many other tissues. So it's only that it was possible for the mouse to supplement or to substitute for the absence of FOSB in most other regards, except in this one. But epistatic effects are very likely in each and every gene. Now, the language. It's true that they said that this is the language gene. That's ridiculous. It's impossible that a complex trait, as the language, depends on one or even 100 genes. It depends on many, many genes. But there are certainly some mutations or some innovations at the genetic level that we can definitely trace to crucial moments. And I think FOSB is going to be one of those. Of course, it only provides language in the context of all the other changes that were happening, okay? But of course, the complexity that you imply in your question and your comment and your observation, I agree completely with it. I agree completely with it. There is, monoamino oxidase, MOA. There, for each gene in a human genome, there are many alleles, right? Many varieties. Some of them have particular functions. We call it penetrance. And some of the mutations in monoamino oxidase gene are extremely penetrant in creating an aggressive behavior. If you inherit one of those, it's very difficult for a person to remain calm and to not be extremely aggressive. And that's what I say. Maybe I'm mistaken. I will check my numbers. But if you inherit that particular mutation and that you are homozygous for that, 90% chance you go to jail in your lifetime. No, I will check it for you. Yeah, I'll give it to you.
Thanks. Probably about 80% of what I wanted to actually say has already been. It's more or less the same point, but yeah, I'll try and push it a little bit further. What would be the state of the art in that sense of, you know, let's call it multi-gene, multi-locus studies? I mean, one of my, you know, obviously you've got to have an admiration and a fascination for everything that's been going on in the last 20 years. But the trouble is, it's a bit like the old thing with the drunk losing his keys at night and looks for them under the light. You know, single snip things associated with very, very recognizable phenotypically, in ailments or diseases is so much easier than trying to get in among all the noise to look at multi-locus traits. Where are we with actually being able to identify, because the thing with behavior, as you say, it has to be multi-locus, right? In general.
Right.
So where are we with, you know, actually being able to have technologies that can actually be able to bring out multi-locus effects as opposed to single-locus effects?
Yes. I think that's also a very, very good question. Thank you for asking it. One approach that is being called GPS. I always remember exactly what it means, because calling it GPS was very, you know, attractive. But it's something like genome-wide polygenic score. So that one takes, without any prejudice, all the traits. The whole genotype, genome-wide, a million positions. And then you try to correlate the million positions with a trait. And when you consider 20, 30 genes, you explain an important percentage of variability. Recently, I attended a conference where this approach was used, and they claimed that they were explaining about 30% of the variance of scholar achievement. This is a last year study. Because that's one very easy to study, according to social sciences I learned, because it's very easy. What is the maximum level of scholarity that you achieve? And using this GPS, they explain a sizable percentage of variance using many genes. No clue as to what the mechanisms are. Whereas when you have a candidate gene, monoamino oxidase or FOSB, then you can probably understand a little bit of what's happening. But the GPS is also an approach. And the other component to your question, I think, is we can now approach this using very large numbers of people, because the genetic component is immediately accessible for a very reasonable amount of money.
Can I just mention quickly why I have a problem with that? So
So it's basically the following. So the thing is that you take as your class, basically scholarly achievement, right? And then you look as your predictor variables, all these different genes, etc. But unless you put in all the other potential social factors like socioeconomic status, et cetera, you have no idea whether your that set of genetic... So in other words, this 30% is really fictional in one sense, right? Because it's only if you put in all the other factors and you really try to disentangle one from the other, you'll be able to say, well, really, it's a proxy for something else, which is really determining the scalarity. Right? You see what I'm saying?
Philosophers. So, undoubtedly, I think 30% of variance explained by the genomic component, it's only in that set of circumstances. If you change the set of circumstances, you may explain more or you may explain less of the variance. Because in some context, genetics is going to be very important. In other contexts, it's going to be almost irrelevant. So that is certainly part of the complexities. And as a scientist and as a molecular scientist, as a chemist that I am in the origin, I like to understand mechanisms, not just correlations. But I think we have now the light. Well, it used to be like a very dim candle. It's a strong light, but very limited. I think we will have, pardon me? Sure. We are still in the stage of phenomenology, just correlations. And in some cases, we start looking at mechanisms and possible interventions, okay? Which is, I think, some of the most interesting possibilities to start using what becomes knowledge, not data, but knowledge, and start to be able to intervene in a useful, constructive way.
We're back to one mic, so. Thank you very much. I would like to ask you about the interest of the epigenetic effect. So the interaction with the environment has an effect in behavior. That behavior can go through memory, maybe changing epigenetics. So there is a very interesting part, which is we want to understand the mechanism. So, but I would like to ask you, beyond the way in which the interaction interacts with the environment, what do you think that is the interest of knowing which processes, which behavioral changes are mediated by epigenetics, for example? Do you think that they are irreversible? So what is the difference? So mechanisms aside, So it's clear that it's interesting just to understand the mechanism. So what is the difference between the relation between my mother with my mother, who was a bad or a good mother, having an influence into my genes and having an influence into my psychology?
I think the answer that you give is the one that I will subscribe. So it is different because one thing is more reversible than the other. Probably the methods that you will use to alleviate suffering or to promote a more constructive social person is different if you know that these are epigenetic effects that are, in a sense, I'm not saying they are irreversible, but the way to make it to make them different is probably very different than the ones that are in your nervous system. As neural circuits. So the plasticity of a neural circuit is inherently different than the plasticity of a turn-off gene at the level of the histones and all that. So probably the mechanism, it's important because it modifies. Maybe one thing, you can do some things with drugs and others you can't. So understanding the intimacies, I think it will be useful. Yeah, of course. What we call the programmed stem cells, it's an exercise of that. You can take a cell that has become a skin, for instance. Lots of genes are there turned on and off. and then you give five genes, five control genes, and after a while, this produces a Nobel Prize, you generate the what is called induced pluripotent stem cells. So you deprogram them. Now, doing that with your nerve cells, your brain cells, it's another matter. But, you know, you can conceive making some of these reversible.
But it's not that I know.
All right.
This is just a question about something you said. I was wondering how you mentioned the cognitive niche and how the constant reorganization of our genes generates some psychiatric illnesses. I was wondering how that works exactly.
Yeah, well, it has only some I don't know if there's a causal relationship with the cognitive niche. The cognitive niche itself is a product of the first manifestations of human intelligence, tool capability, and the consequential social modification of social interactions. Then it creates a new niche, which was not natural. So, and now for an individual that belongs to that new community or that community, now his or her survival depends on being able to progress in that created, you know, niche. So that's what is the cognitive niche. It's like the beavers create a niche because they make the dams. Okay, and now the beavers, to progress, they need to learn how, and their genes evolve in a created niche. Now, in the case of humans, we created the cognitive niche, which is a niche in which only the progress depends on the capability of understanding things, of making better tools, of reading the other's faces and having an emotional relationship. That's what it's called the cognitive niche. Now, the other thing is, very surprisingly, the human genome has dynamics on it of its all its own, which are different from even our closest relatives. Why is that? I don't know. Is that responsible for generating species with the very, you know, unique characteristics? It's been, you know, 400 million years since there are animals, and 100 million years after the dinosaurs, and it's only one species that has evolved these unique capabilities. Now, studying the genome is very provocative to see that our genome is also unique in the sense that it recombines and generates duplications at a higher pace than others. We don't exactly understand what is happening, but we also understand that some of the mental illnesses are products of these rearrangements, not of conventional mutations. So we generate mentally ill members of our species at a higher rate than expected by simple mutations. Okay? And some of these rearrangements of the genome create modifications on the neural nervous system. That's very, you know, it's surprising.
Related to this cognitive niche, I was thinking, is there any theory or some way to explain, because the cognitive niche could be first very primary or basic, no? Then it has been developed and there are different skills or capabilities within it. For example, evaluation, and maybe even moral or thinking and just getting information as a receptor, processing, I don't know. But what I want to know is if there is any research which relates these different capabilities to certain... the names of these genetic parts, I don't know, I don't understand very well, or is it more general?
You know, I think the concept is more general, but it's probably an approach to trying to understand some of the changes that we do start to list, you know, and to detect. So gene variants or alleles are related to different characteristics. Sometimes they are just immaterial and they don't matter. Most of the cases they don't matter. They're just silent, you know, irrelevant. But some of them do have some effects. And so in relating to your question, I agree with you that one has to conceive the cognitive niche as something that has evolved itself, you know, with human societies. And of course, Homo erectus was very different from Homo sapiens. You know, a million years ago, it was not the same. And even the agricultural revolution created new niches and modified larger societies, modified it. Evolution never ceases. It's impossible for it to cease. It's, you know, it's an intrinsic characteristic of the biological being to evolve. But of course, recently evolution, I think the cognitive niche is changing so fast, so that there is no possibility for a systematic trend in evolution of the human species. It's not that we are not evolving, it's only that we are evolving in a Brownian movement, I think. We're not evolving in any particular direction, because these processes take many generations. Yet, of course, in historic times, the cognitive niche have changed very dramatically. I'm not sure that it has had an impact on gene frequencies, you know, gene variance frequencies in different populations. That would be the way to study it.
I just wanted to make an invitation to everybody in the conference and to Dr. Sobran too, although actually you're involved already, even though you probably don't know it. In one of the big projects we have here in SE3 is essentially associated with obesity as the principal things that we're going to be looking at. And the behavior component, the emotion component is absolutely fundamental. You know, you obviously don't have time to go into that now, but we're working with Samuel Canizales in Mekin, where we're going to be trying to do a genome-wide study of as many people as possible, while we're also looking, we're going to be doing psychological experiments to be looking at cognitive biases. You know, in other words, why do people misperceive, for instance, their weight? Right. So essentially, it's why do people lie to themselves, even though they're actually not lying. They actually believe what they're actually seeing, right? And the thing is, obviously, I think with the Seminario Permanente here in as our neighbors, the aspects, the psychological aspects, the emotional aspects are absolutely fundamental. And we would love to have any participation from anybody here who is interested in, you know, solving probably what might be the major medical problem of our time, the obesity epidemic.
Very briefly, yeah, I will be very interested in participating. And I agree that it's precisely this emotional and also all the other environmental factors that are responsible for the obesity epidemic, because genetics is exactly the same that it was 50 years ago for all practical purposes. So the heritability of obesity diminished with the changes in society. It used to be much more heritable than it is now. So now it's mainly social, emotional. Yet we can conduct a GPS. We can do a GPS and see which genes and maybe which is more prone to become obese and maybe do different.
More questions? No. Todo está.
Shall we start?
I think so.
Okay. So the next speaker, Michael Brady, he's professor of philosophy at the University of Glasgow. His research focuses on issues in the philosophy of emotion, ethics, and epistemology. He was co-principal investigator on a major three-year interdisciplinary research project, The Value of Suffering. He's a well-known moral philosopher who has published widely exploring the relations among emotion, reason, and value.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank, first of all Beth for organising what's currently, maybe until this paper, is going to be a fascinating workshop. I've learnt a lot today, and it's material I'm not familiar with, and so I've learnt a great deal, and the papers thus far have been great. I'd also like to thank Katya for splendid organisational work thus far, and also Daniel for his great organisation. So many thanks for that. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. It's the second time I've been in Mexico City. I'm coming again in March next year, and hopefully visit many more times. So it's an absolute delight to be here and see the blue sky and the sunshine, which you don't get much of in Glasgow. The topic is suffering, punishment, and justice, and it's the result of, well, it's one of the papers that's the result of our three-year Value of Suffering project. David Bain was my co-principal investigator, and we completed the project end of July. And it's a project about the nature and value of suffering. And David approaches this more from the philosophy of mind. I approach it more from the philosophy of emotion and maybe from moral philosophy. So that's going to be my topic today. People say you shouldn't start with an apology. Always a bad idea to do that when you're giving a presentation. I'm going to start with two. So sorry about this. Unlike all the really nice presentations thus far, this is just going to be black and white. No pictures. It's just text. So it might be a little bit boring there. Maybe not an apology, but it's a point of difference between my paper and the papers thus far. My paper's interdisciplinary in the sense that it connects, I think, philosophy with theology, with criminology, thoughts about judicial punishment. There's very little. There's one piece of data right at the end, and that's quite old. That's the only connection with maybe what would be broadly discussed as science. So it's not going to line up with a lot of the empirical work thus far. Maybe that's a good thing, maybe that's a bad thing, I don't know, but that's my caveat right at the beginning. So it will be lots of philosophy. Hopefully it won't just be intuition mongering, it won't just be armchair theorising, but I want to make sense of various things that I find puzzling in various realms when we think about suffering. Okay, let's begin. Here's some preliminaries. If you were at the talk on Monday, this will be familiar to you. Here's what I think suffering is. I think it's essentially, at least I'm going to talk about it as an essentially experiential state, characterized by unpleasantness or negative affect, a state in which we experience pain or misery, distress, loss, hardship. So unpleasantness is common to all of these. That's how I want to understand suffering. At least I think that's an essential part of suffering. But I also think suffering involves a little bit more than that. I think it involves an element of negative affect plus an attitude towards that affect. So there's two components of a state of suffering. So one, element of negative affect, two, an attitude towards that affect. I think the attitude is one of a current desire that occupies attention, that features in your reasoning or your deliberations. And so in the slogan, suffering is unpleasantness that we mind, that we want to stop. Lots of people had worries about this on Monday. If you weren't there, then I disposed of them competently. So there's no more worries remaining about that. Just take that as no, I'm joking. But that's the view of suffering that I think is correct. And that's the view of suffering that I've been developing in various chapters of a book I've written. So that's another preliminary. So here are types of suffering, the kinds of things I'm going to be talking about. There's physical suffering, pain, hunger, tiredness, etc. You all know kinds of physical suffering. And also I think there's emotional suffering, grief, remorse, disappointment, guilt, shame, and so on. So that's the phenomena, that's what I think suffering is, and that's something I talked about on Monday. Here are two ways in which you might think suffering is related to virtue. So the overall project is to explain, on my view, the value of suffering in terms of its contribution to virtue. And I think since you might think virtue is essential to happiness, then the conclusion would be forms of suffering are essential for us to live a happy life. That's the overall project. And I'm going to explain in the book how suffering is essential for various kinds of virtue. So there's different dimensions of this. One is the following, and this is what I talked about and argued for on Monday. A disposition to suffer in various ways, physically and emotionally, can itself be virtuous, insofar as this suffering reliably brings about certain valuable ends. So suffering itself can be virtuous, or a disposition to suffer can be constitutive of, or partly constitutive of, a virtue. For instance, think of physical pain, which reliably motivates, in the right circumstances, damage avoidance and repair. And you might think, if that's true, then physical pain can, or disposition to feel pain in the right circumstances, can itself be virtuous. So pain can be virtuous and therefore intrinsically valuable on that view. Think of guilt or remorse, which reliably motivate apologies and reparations in the right circumstances. Guilt and remorse can themselves be virtuous. They can be constituents of virtue. So that's what I talked about on Monday. I think, I didn't talk about this, but I mentioned it during questions. Suffering can be productive, instrumental towards certain higher level or regulatory virtues. So suffering can be in and of itself intrinsically good, but also instrumentally good because it brings about higher level, very important regulatory virtues. For instance, if you follow Nietzsche, one of the few philosophers, along with Schopenhauer, who've talked about suffering, so he thinks suffering is essential for virtues constitutive of strength of character. Psychological health and strength for Nietzsche just is the overcoming of suffering. He thinks suffering is inevitable for creatures like us, and a truly strong and healthy person is the one who can overcome suffering. So suffering is essential for strength of character and for health. Indeed, he thought the really strong people would go after more suffering, try and embrace more, take on more responsibility so that they suffer more, so that they can be stronger and healthier. That's Nietzsche's view. Well, if that's true, you might think suffering is important for a higher level regulatory virtue, because strength of character is very important for us to achieve an awful lot of things. In particular, strength of character is sometimes really important for us to cope with physical pain and emotional grief and suffering. So suffering at the higher level is important for coping with suffering at the lower level. And it's part of what makes suffering at the lower level virtuous, you might think. That's what Nietzsche thinks. Other people have thought suffering is essential for moral wisdom. In order to get proper, deep understanding of moral values, of goodness and badness, rightness and wrongness, in all their various forms, you have to suffer. Suffering is essential for knowledge of negative value, you might think. So you might think that you don't really know what's truly repellent until you've been repelled by something. You don't know what's truly disgusting until you've been disgusted. Truly shameful until you've been ashamed. If that's true, then you have to suffer in these ways. You have to undergo negative affective experience to be truly wise, because the wise people know what's good and bad. They have understanding of value and disvalue. Suffering is important because it constitutes virtue itself. Suffering is important because it helps in the production of higher level regulatory virtues. Strength of character and moral and evaluative wisdom. I'm not going to talk about that either, sorry. So I talked about one on Monday, not going to talk about two. Today I'm going to talk about something else. And this is the role, the third relation between suffering and virtue, and it's the role that suffering plays in producing and promoting and helping to express social virtue. So suffering is important for us to be virtuous at the individual level, and suffering is important for social groups to function properly. And it's important, therefore, for the functioning of social groups in various interesting, I think, ways. I think suffering is essential for social virtue along a number of particular dimensions. For justice, for love, and for faith, / trust, / solidarity. Lots of different ways in which we can unpack these different values and virtues, but that's what I want to talk about today. Why suffering is really important for social functioning, and you don't get properly functioning social groups unless you get groups embodying these kinds of virtues or certain kinds of relationships. That's the thought. This idea is most familiar from religious traditions, but they have secular counterparts. The problem about writing about suffering as a philosopher is very few philosophers wrote about it, so you look elsewhere for inspiration. And lots of people in various religious traditions have talked about suffering. So that's where I'm starting. This isn't a theodicy. I'm not trying to convince anyone. I'm not trying to solve the problem of evil. I just think there's interesting things that theists have said about suffering. And interestingly, these have secular counterparts, clear secular counterparts to religious discussions about the value of suffering. So that's what I'm going to talk about today. And in particular, try and fix a problem, both in religious and secular thinking about a particular kind of social value. That's the target. Okay, so I don't think this is any kind of, I'm trying to sell you a theodicy here, but I think there's interesting things you can get from looking at certain religious traditions. Okay. Here's what I also think forms of suffering are necessary for the proper functioning of social groups in general, not just, you might think, certain religious communities, but for secular groups in general. Okay. And I think looking at secular traditions helps to solve a particular problem that religious traditions have when it comes to the value of suffering. That's why I'm going to look at both, looking at both in parallel. And so I think looking at secular suffering helps, or suffering in the secular realm helps with respect to suffering in certain religious traditions. So it's interdisciplinary, but it's kind of wide-ranging and kind of highly theoretical. That's the thought. Okay, let's begin. And the main one I want to talk about is suffering and justice, but I'll talk about suffering and the other kinds of social virtues towards the end, if I have time. Okay. Why do we suffer? Big question. A question that we made small steps towards answering in the 3 years of the project, but that's a big question. From religious tradition, Judeo-Christian and Islamic justifications for suffering, there's a variety of reasons why we suffer, a variety of explanations that talk about the value of suffering. Suffering is important because it's punishment for sin. And as punishment for sin, suffering ensures justice. That's one thing you find in religious traditions. That's one justification, one explanation for why we suffer. And therefore, the value of suffering is ensuring justice in the divine realm. Here's another one. Suffering is an expression of love, and is important and essential, therefore, for loving relationships, various forms of loving relationships. And suffering is a test of faith. You see all of these ideas in certain religious traditions. You have the third one because we have to explain, if you're a theist, why God makes the innocent suffer. That can't be punishment for sin because they've not sinned. So that's a test for faith, or that's an expression of love. Those are the three ideas that are prominent in certain religious traditions. I'm going to focus on one, and possibly two, and if we get time, we'll talk about three. I want to investigate these ideas, focusing on the first, an attention that seems to be inherent in both religious and secular thinking about suffering as punishment for sin. Particular kind of puzzle when you look at biblical expressions of that, and also secular variants of the kind of ideas you get in the Bible. Okay. So let's have a look at this in a little bit more detail. The idea that suffering is punishment for sin suggests, and this is the connection with virtue and social virtue, that it's essential for justice, understood in what we call retributivist terms. The Latin root of retributivist, re and tribuo, means I pay back. So the thought is by making the sinner suffer, or making the wrongdoer suffer, that's paying them back for their wrongdoing. And if you think that that's what justice is, then suffering is essential for justice, understood in retributivist terms. You do wrong, you get punished, that's your payment. That's what justice is. Common idea in the Old Testament, as we'll see. So in Deuteronomy, Moses tells the people of Israel that if thou wilt not hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe, to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. If you don't follow the commandments, if you don't obey the rules, if you violate them, if you do wrong, this is what's going to happen. You'll be punished. And amongst the curses, pestilence, victory of one's enemies, spousal infidelity, failure of grape and grain, bodily consumption by birds of the air and beasts of the land, etc. Now, that's what's going to happen. Now, we'll talk later when we look at judicial punishment. That's not the kind of thing that might be justified if you want an appropriate judicial form of punishment. But that's a basic idea as expressed in Deuteronomy and as expressed elsewhere in the Old Testament. Romans, God will render to every man according to his deeds. So you'll get what you deserve. That's the kind of point as expressed in Romans. So God punishes sinners because this is what their conduct merits or deserves. And that's what justice is on this view. And suffering will be essential to punishment on this line. So in so doing, God expresses and ensures justice. Common idea in the Old Testament. Okay. So again, to characterize this in terms of the virtue of justice, Jeremiah, I, the Lord, search the heart and examine the mind to reward each person according to their conduct, according to what their deeds deserve. Again, retributivist account of justice, getting what you deserve. Deuteronomy, the rock, his work is perfect, for all his ways are justice. A God of faithfulness and without iniquity, just and upright is he. It's not vengeance, it's not mere whim. God's doing this because that's what justice requires. That's the line. You find it all over the place. And here's one idea behind this. It's an idea that ultimately I don't think is going to work, but there's something to the idea that the punishment ensures fairness. It means that the powerful don't get away with it. The wicked shall not prosper. So by punishing them, God ensures that they're brought down to the level or below the level that they were before they committed their wicked deeds. So that's an idea of justice as fairness in terms of bringing people down when they profited. Okay, that's the idea behind the wicked shall not prosper. I don't think that's the right account of an appropriate justice, but that's certainly something lots of people think. Okay, prominent idea in the Old Testament, prominent idea in the Bible, but that's not the only idea. And here's where the puzzle comes. There's another way of viewing God's punishment of wrongdoers. There's another way of viewing a justification of suffering in biblical terms. And you're going to see secular parallels of both of these ideas as we progress. Here's the other idea that's prominent in the Bible. It's a form of loving discipline or rebuke. On the one hand, punishment for sin is a way of giving sinners what they deserve, maybe ensuring fairness. But lots of other places you have the idea that it's an expression of loving discipline. It's rebuke to benefit the person who's disciplined. Not to benefit the person who was wronged in this case, but to benefit the person who's disciplined. So, Revelation, those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. That's why you're being rebuked and disciplined, so you repent, and therefore you enjoy eternal bliss. Deuteronomy, again, know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, so the Lord your God disciplines you. Nevertheless, when we are judged in this way by the Lord, we're being disciplined so that we will not be finally condemned with the world. There's a different idea here. It's not giving people what they deserve. It's a form of education, or at least discipline, so that the sinner will benefit, so that they won't be finally condemned in this world. And that's a different justification for suffering, a different idea that suffering has value. It has value as loving discipline and rebuke, to reform the sinner. The idea that you find elsewhere. So in Hebrews, perhaps the most obvious expression of this idea, endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as his children. For what children are not disciplined by their father? No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who've been trained by it. That's what Hebrews says. Okay. So the aim of discipline isn't justice. Justice has seemed to, it's fallen out of the picture here. That social value is no longer prominent. Rather, it's the good of the individual who suffers. That's the point of God imposing punishment on sinners. Okay. So two different ideas you find in the Bible, and I bet you can think of the secular equivalents if you think about contemporary literature on punishment. So by punishing, God seeks to educate and reform sinners. That's the idea. Here's one question. But how can these be compatible? Maybe a question for biblical scholars, but you might just think, well, how do we make sense of these two ideas? That suffering is valuable because it gives the sinner, the wrongdoer, what they deserve, and therefore it ensures justice. It has that social value. It produces that social virtue. But also suffering is valuable because it promotes reform. It's a form of loving discipline, and it's valuable in that way socially as well. It has a relation to that kind of social virtue. How can these two perspectives be compatible? And that's what I want to investigate. And I think they can be compatible, but only when we go via a secular account of just punishment. which shows that suffering really is essential for justice and essential for reform. If that's true, you can appeal to a secular idea of just punishment in order to solve that biblical problem. Maybe you don't have that biblical problem. Maybe you just think, I don't care, and that's fair enough. But you might think there are secular parallels of the very same problem if you think secular punishment is supposed to ensure retribution in the sense of giving the wrongdoer or criminal what they deserve. And also, the point of punishment is to ensure reform. Two common ideas in contemporary accounts of judicial punishment, appropriate judicial punishment. Well, how can they be compatible? And oftentimes, when people talk about judicial punishment, people jettison one of the ideas. Only one's really important. Only one takes priority. So we'll see whether that's going to be a plausible line to take. Okay. Well, here are a couple of suggestions as to how these can be compatible, and I don't think they work, and I don't think they're going to work in the secular realm either. I don't think this is going to be justification for punishment. One really simple idea: justice was really prevalent in the Old Testament. Loving concern is central to the New Testament. So you just have a shift in perspective here. And that's what explains these different quotations. And given quotations apart from one of them, they split along those lines. And you might think, well, that's what's going on. No incompatibility, no problem here. There's just a shift in the perspective of Christian thought. That, I don't think, isn't going to work. So the idea would be to repeat, move from a justice-based account of punishment to a caring-based account represents a development in Christian thought. Moving from a particular kind of model of cold virtue in terms of justice and retribution to a warm virtue of loving concern. That's common in virtue ethics to talk about those two kinds of virtues. Why might that be problematic? Well, for the following reason. It's not obvious that discipline in the New Testament is only concerned with reform. It seems it's also concerned with justice. I mean, just think of the parallel with parental discipline here. In the loving parent will discipline her child only when this is merited or a warranted response to wrongdoing. It's not purely instrumental. The loving parent, the good parent, will ensure that they rebuke or discipline their child, but only when what they've done is merited or warranted. So it's not simply a concern with reform, it's reform when what they've done would be just. So you don't get that really simple explanation, because in the New Testament, I take it, then loving discipline is only for people who've sinned. And so it's justice as well. You don't do it to reform people who are innocent. So it's implausible to suppose that no dual concern in the New Testament. Seems to be a dual concern there as well. So you don't get that simple explanation of this incompatibility in religious thinking. Okay, that's one shot. That's not going to work. A second one. Why not just say, look, there are two concerns. God's concerned both with punishment to ensure justice, both with giving what the sinner deserves, and also to bring about reform. Why can't there just be two dual concerns? And that explains the fact that there's no incompatibility. You can certainly have two different goals, two compatible goals in this kind of case. Well, I don't think in this kind of case you really can have compatible goals, because if you have both, then there's going to be potential clashes between justice and reform here. And when you do, you're forced to answer some difficult questions at the theoretical level. Which of these has priority? If there are these two joint concerns, and I take it's theoretically possible for them to clash, for justice to clash with reform in this case, given that they're two independent concerns, why not think this is possible? Which of them has priority? Which is the concern that we take, or the social value we take, to be most valuable? And either of these answers, if you think they're completely independent, if you think justice and reform are completely independent, either of the answers is going to be problematic. Suppose you say justice takes precedence. That's the point of a judicial system. That's the point of punishment, to ensure justice. That's the primary aim. Then reform is a kind of bonus, and it falls away. It doesn't seem to take reform seriously enough if you prioritize justice in this way. If you think that justice always trumps reform in this case, justice is really the one prime social value here. So that has its costs, if you take that line. What if you think, as lots of people do, that reform takes precedence and justice is what's known as a side constraint? You can do things to reform, but only insofar as this is compatible with justice. Well, that's one way. That's a lot of reformists in legal philosophy and work theorists on punishment. They think that about reform. Justice is merely a side constraint on what you can do to educate and reform people. Then you lose the central idea of the Old Testament, that suffering is imposed as a way of giving the sinner what they deserve. So then the idea that punishment is essential for justice kind of falls out of the picture. It's really reform which takes priority here. And that's going to happen. You're going to have problematic clashes if you think justice and reform are independent values that either God or the state seeks to promote. You're always going to get these clashes. So what's the solution to this kind of clash? This kind of clash that you find in here. Unless justice and reform are somehow related, they're radically different ideas expressed in the different in the Old Testament and the New Testament, and you might think radically different ideas are expressed in contemporary theorizing about just punishment, and therefore contemporary theorizing about the value of suffering from a social perspective. So this tension is mirrored in secular discussions of legitimate punishment by retributivists and reformists. And you just get a clash, and you either say, I'm going to be retributivist and prioritize justice, or reformist and prioritize return, and that's where the debate will lie here. So you just reject the other value. You just reject the other kind of social virtue. And maybe you're happy to do that. Maybe you think reform isn't important. It's giving the wrongdoer what they deserve. That's at the heart of punishment. Or maybe you think there's something deeply wrong about retributivist accounts of punishment. You should only punish in order to reform the wrongdoer. Maybe you think that. So you're not bothered about both elements. But I think it'd be more satisfying if you had an account which could capture both. Not in a way of just saying you have dual aims, but in a way that shows how these are connected, in such a way that you resolve this kind of tension. That would be good at the secular level. That would be good at the religious level as well, if you're concerned with the tension in certain religious traditions. So what I want to do is propose a way of resolving that tension, which would work in a secular level, and then it can be reapplied to the religious. Okay. And this is going to be what thinking about the value of suffering tells us, I think, about legitimate or appropriate punishment, and why suffering is important for legitimate or appropriate punishment. In interesting ways, I hope. It might be argued that punishment as an expression of loving concern is compatible with, because it's an essential part of justice. You don't have two different independent values here. Punishment as the expression of loving concern is essential to justice. It's an essential part of justice, giving the wrongdoer what they deserve. So justice understood in retributivist terms. And you might think these things are necessarily incompatible. Giving the sinner wrongdoer what they deserve and reforming them are incompatible. No, they're not. Not if you think that suffering, the imposition of suffering as an expression of loving concern, is a part of what it is to ensure a just outcome. So punishment's justified and appropriate only when it aims at reforming the sinner by giving him what he deserves. Similarly, punishment's justified and appropriate only when it aims at reforming the wrongdoer or the criminal by giving him or her what he or she deserves. In which case, you resolve the tension by saying these are both integral parts of a single notion of just punishment. That's the idea. And that will resolve the tension at secular level and at the religious. Okay. So suffering will be integral to ensuring justice via punishment, because hopefully what we'll see is the legitimate imposition of suffering has this very same aim. When the state imposes suffering on wrongdoers, that's the aim, to reform them by giving them what they deserve. That's all pretty abstract. So let's fill it in by looking at a particular account of punishment, which shows how these dual goals and values are essentially connected. And that's a contemporary account of secular punishment, and it's one that solves, I think, a whole bunch of problems in this area. Okay. So why believe this? I think a plausible secular account of punishment holds that appropriate or legitimate punishment is retributivist. So retributivism's correct. And it necessarily expresses concern for the wrongdoer. And it aims at getting the wrongdoers to reform. So reform, reformist accounts of punishment are correct. A particular secular account has all of these elements and shows how they're related. And once we look at this in detail, we'll see why suffering is important to bring about these goals and therefore to ensure social justice. That's the thought. Okay. So what's this account? It's what's known as the communicative theory of punishment. I mentioned a little bit on Monday about suffering can have communicative value. So it has, and that's part of its role in social context. And it has clear communicative value in this particular contemporary account of just punishment. Okay, what does this theory of punishment say? The ultimate justification of imposing or inflicting suffering on someone is that it serves a communicative purpose. And there's various dimensions of the communication here. But that's the ultimate justification. In fact, that's the only legitimate justification for making people suffer if you're part of the state. Without the communicative function, then imposition of suffering is just unjustified, and there can't be any appropriate legitimate judicial punishment. That's what the communicative theory says. So the ultimate justification is communicative. And this captures both retributivist and reformist thinking. And in a way, it's a way of showing that retributivism has a core element that just seems obviously true. Not obviously true if you think retributivism is a matter of vengeance, but if you think that what's essential when someone's done something wrong is that you communicate to something that they deserve. Okay. Because what is communicated in punishment is something that is merited or deserved by the criminal. So retributivism is correct. What punishment communicates is what the criminal deserves. Why? Well, here's, at the very least, what criminals deserve. They deserve censure and condemnation. You do something wrong, then at the very least, you merit that. You merit censure and condemnation. Forget about hard treatment or anything like that. You do something wrong, then you merit being told and being censured for your wrongdoing. You merit being condemned for what you did. I think everyone's going to agree with that. Wrongdoers merit and deserve that. So by condemning and censoring them, you're giving them what they deserve. And the idea is going to be, by punishing criminals, that's part of what's communicated. The state's censure and condemnation of violating the state's laws. But it's an internal goal of such communication, and this is why it's a communicative theory, that the criminal acknowledges their crime, make reparations, and reform themselves. That's the internal goal of communicating censure and condemnation. Now, reformism is problematic because you might be a utilitarian and say, really, you can reform people by doing all kinds of things. This might be related to some of the things we'll have in discussion related to your paper. That you could make people better by doing all kinds of things that don't treat them with respect, don't treat them as a person. So I think one of the horrors in Clockwork Orange is what the state does. Who's the character? The main character in Clockwork Orange? No, not the writer, the character. The Alex, yeah. So Alex is kind of tortured and it's reformist, but it's kind of really instrumental to make him a better person. And that's reformist. But it's not making him a better person by communicating anything. It's making him a better person by brainwashing him. So you might think the internal goal of communication isn't just to make people better. It's to get them to acknowledge what they've done, to repent, to reform themselves, and therefore benefit. If you think this is what's going on in imposition of punishment, you give people what they deserve by censuring and condemning them, and the internal goal of this, because it's communication rather than mere instrumental imposition of suffering, is to get them to be better off. That's the thought. Okay. So why communicate this by making them suffer? Why can't you, in a legal situation, communicate the state censure and condemnation, disapproval of what they did, just by telling them? Why hard treatment? Why make criminals suffer? What's the point of suffering to ensure the right kind of communication and the right kind of reform? Well, here's the idea. This is an idea presented by Anthony Duff, who's one of the major communicative theorists, but it captures why suffering might be essential for just punishment, understood along these lines. So the aim of hard treatment, the aim of imposing suffering on people, is to persuade, not to force, to persuade the offender to recognise and repent the wrong he's done, and so to recognise the need to reform himself and his future conduct, and to make apologetic reparation to those he has wronged. That's the aim of hard treatment. And there's lots of interesting discussions about the precise nature of that, precise nature of suffering that would be legitimate and would be illegitimate. But that's the aim, according to the communicative theory, to get the person to recognise and repent, to acknowledge they've done something wrong, to apologise, make reparations, and to seek to change themselves. That's what Duff thinks. If you think that, if you think that's the aim of communication, punishment, you might think, well, repentance is necessarily painful. In aiming to induce repentance, punishment thus aims to bring offenders to suffer what they deserve to suffer, the pains of repentance and remorse. So at least there's that connection between legitimate punishment and suffering. Repentance is painful. Genuine acknowledgement is painful. And by punishment, you aim to get the person to suffer the pains of remorse, because that's the internal aim of punishment, so that they make apologetic reparation for those they've wronged, to recognise the need to reform themselves. So that apologies are legitimate, you might think. A genuine apology requires the person feel what they've done once they acknowledge their crime. Okay, that's one connection. But that's maybe not the main connection. Why is the state justified in imposing suffering on others? That might be consequential. Genuine or constitutive. Genuine acknowledgement of your wrongdoing will hurt if you're abnormal. That's a condition for it to be genuine, you might think. Genuinely for you to get what you've done. If you don't feel bad about it, you don't really grasp, you don't really understand the nature of your wrongdoing. That's the idea there. But why is the state justified in imposing that on others? Here's why. Deprivations and suffering ensure that the criminal cannot easily ignore his or her wrongdoing. Instead, they focus attention on this and aim to motivate reflection. And here's what I say here ties into some of the things I was saying on Monday. The point of imposing suffering is to focus attention, motivate reflection, acknowledgement, and therefore repentance. So the imposition of hard treatment is supposed to do that. It's not supposed to force someone to repent, it's supposed to get them to reflect and repent under their own steam, but to provide the conditions in which likely that they do that. That's the kind of idea going on here. And here's why. So this won't be news to you. If you've done something wrong, it's really tempting to say, I've done something wrong, sorry, and that's it. And you say you're sorry. But you might think you've not really acknowledged what you've done wrong. You've not really repented. Because that's difficult. Repentance doesn't go deep when you merely say you're sorry. And if it doesn't go deep, you might think you're not fully committed to reforming yourself. So you all know how easy it is to make apologies if you just say the words. You just say the words. That's really easy. But to genuinely acknowledge your wrongdoing, to make it part of yourself, to genuinely repent, hurts. And that requires more effort. That requires a situation where you take it seriously. But given the cost of doing that, given that it is difficult, it's really tempting not to do it, just as it's really tempting to reevaluate when you've done something wrong, to reevaluate whether you've really done it wrong. You might think instead, you know what, I didn't do anything wrong, I'm not going to apologise. Why should I apologise? That's a temptation, because apologies and reparations are costly. If you don't really acknowledge, if acknowledgement and repentance don't go deep, it won't effectively motivate reform. You won't change yourself. You'll keep doing it and keep making the apologies. That's the kind of thought. So here's what the imposition of suffering does, was meant to do on this view. It's supposed to focus attention on wrongdoing. In the same way that pain and other negative affective experience focuses attention on their objects and inclines the subject to reflect upon wrongdoing. So I said on Monday, one of the things that pain does, it focuses attention so that ignoring the pain isn't, in the long term at least, possible. Dealing with the pain is prioritized by the fact that it's unpleasant, by the fact that it's a form of suffering. That's part of what pain does. That's why it's effective. If it was easy to ignore the potential bodily damage, then you would do. And that's true of smokers, people who drink too much, people who eat too much. If it's really easy to ignore that because it doesn't hurt, you'll do it because there are great benefits from continuing to smoke and drink and overeat. You get great pleasure by doing that. So the point of pain is to focus on its attention on potential bodily damage in a way that you can't easily ignore it. You might think the same thing's going on here. Hard treatment provides the conditions in which the wrongdoing of the criminal cannot be easily ignored by them. It focuses attention on their wrongdoing in the same way that pain and other negative affective experience focuses attention on their objects. Here's why it's a communicative theory. It doesn't force the subject to reflect, and that would be incompatible with communication. You're communicating if you're in a state that the person's violated the rules and violated the norms, and you're communicating this to them. You're not forcing them to. You're providing the conditions in which they do it themselves, because only if they do it themselves will reform and apologies and repentance go deep. Just like, you might think parents might force their children to apologize. You might think that's not a genuine apology. The only reason the kid's doing it is because their parents have threatened them if they didn't. That's not the right kind of apology. That's not the right kind of state in which the kid will change their behavior. Something similar is going on here. So by providing the conditions in which they reflect on what they've done, but by not forcing them, you treat the person with respect. So by making them suffer, it's a way of respecting the criminal, respecting their rational capacity to acknowledge for themselves what they've done is wrong. And that's the problem with lots of reformist accounts. They don't acknowledge that. They don't recognize that the criminal is a reflective, responsible, reasonable agent. Okay. So instead, it provides motive and opportunity for the criminal to reflect and deliberate and to face up to what he or she did. So the point isn't that suffering will necessarily bring about repentance and reform. As you know, lots of criminals are recidivists. They don't repent. They don't reform. They don't acknowledge their crimes. So it's not going to force it. They won't necessarily make this happen. Instead, the understanding that's central to these for fallible agents like us will be unlikely without the focused attention that suffering brings. It may be impossible. I mean, in the pain case, if you're pain insensitive, it's highly unlikely, maybe impossible for you to survive without the kind of focused attention that pain, physical pain, brings. Well, the same might be true of imposition of hard treatment at the judicial level. You don't get these values unless you provide a situation in which the criminals are motivated to reflect on what they did and reform themselves. That's the thought. For creatures like us. So if the state wants to achieve these valuable ends, to censure and condemn wrongdoing, to communicate the fact that this person's violated norms that the state takes very seriously, to communicate that concern, and to communicate concern for the criminal by treating them as a responsible, reasonable agent. So giving them the opportunity to reflect, acknowledge, repent, and reform themselves. Then you're going to have to make criminals suffer. That's the thought. This provides the means in which criminals reform themselves. Without that, it's incompatible with treating them as reasonable, rational people. Okay. None of this justifies the usual forms of hard treatment in most of the countries in the world. Certainly doesn't justify locking people away for 23 hours a day, or doesn't justify solitary confinement, doesn't maybe justify incarceration. That kind of hard treatment might not be justified at all, because that might not be the way in which people are in the circumstances where they'd reflect on what they did. Attention is focused in the wrong way. So it's not justifying the kind of hard treatment that goes on, but it is justifying the importance of some form of suffering if we are to get these important goals. Okay, so that's an important caveat there. Let's return then to the religious realm. So here's the question. God's punishment of sinners is supposed to express God's love. This is what sinners deserve. That's what justice is. So also supposed to be akin to a parent's loving discipline. James at getting sinners to repent and reform, and so be united with God in heaven. How are these compatible? Well, if something like the communicative theory of punishment's right in the secular realm, then you might think God's imposition of suffering might be justified, both as an instance of giving sinners what they deserve, namely censure and condemnation for violating the laws, and through this act motivating them to acknowledge their sin, repent, and reform themselves. And after all, I take it it's important for the kind of Christian tradition that the sinners themselves have to acknowledge. It's not that they're forced to do so. They have to acknowledge under their own will. Only then will they be forgiven. So you might think that the imposition of suffering is a way in which to motivate this kind of reflection and therefore to achieve this social good as well. Okay, and another important caveat, that's not going to justify a lot of the suffering inflicted in the Old Testament, the kind of things I mentioned earlier, so that's not going to be the right kind of thing. But in principle, it would make these two views on the justification of suffering, infliction of suffering, compatible. So God's imposition of suffering provides a structure in which sinners can come to acknowledge their sin and repent. So it just mirrors the kind of secular story we've told here. So if you're a theist, you'll like this story. If you're a non-theist, you don't care at all about the Bible, at least you might think, here's a way in which you can get a justification for state imposition of suffering. It's important and indeed essential for the social value and virtue of justice. Okay. Conclusion. For this part, just I've got a couple more things to say. Some system of punishment is vital for social flourishing, and suffering is essential for just punishment. That's what this is proposing. So suffering thus counts as necessary for a social virtue and a vital social good, if this kind of theory is correct, and it has virtues that other theories of punishment don't. Very quickly, suffering and other social virtues, and this will be essential to the communicative role of suffering on the social level. So once we see that suffering has a communicative function, we see the other important roles, social roles that suffering plays. One is this: suffering can communicate love and it can strengthen loving relationships when one suffers for the sake of others. So you might think suffering is essential for deep loving relationships. Biblical perspective, as you know, if you know the New Testament, Jesus suffers for the sins of others. That's the central theme in the New Testament. But secular perspective, obvious secular perspective, and loving relationships are strengthened through the expression of suffering for the other. And you might think this is really important for you to know, for you to communicate your love for another person, for the other person to know that you love them. And you might think in that way, suffering strengthens loving relationships. Why? Because it expresses a selfless attitude. I mean, you might say you do anything for the other person, and people often do. But when times get tough, push comes to shove, people don't. In which case, they value their own well-being and comfort more than they value the comfort of other people. If you endure suffering for the sake of others, then you know that the priorities are right. You value them more than your own comfort or well-being. Communicating that to another person, you see, that's really important for loving relationships. You've not just said the words, you've shown them by your deeds and by your feelings, by expressing suffering, how much they mean, and they're the number one priority. So you can see how suffering is important for deepened loving relationships. So to this extent, it's not just actions, but feelings that speak louder than words. You might never know, unless you go through hard times, that the person genuinely loves you, or at least thinks that you're more important than their own comfort and well-being. But it's important to know that for loving, committed relationships. Okay. Finally, suffering can communicate possession of virtue. It's not just good for developing virtues, or it's not just constitutive of virtues. It can communicate your possession of virtue. It could be a test. Again, biblical perspective, and you'll get a secular equivalent. The book of Job, God tests Abraham. The book of Job and God's testing Abraham. James, happy the man who remains steadfast under trial, for having passed that test he will receive for his prize, the gift promised to those who love God. So, book of Job, Job was having a final time, and it's kind of unfair because, you know, God and Satan are having a chat. And Satan says he only obeys you because he's got a really easy life. Make it difficult and he wouldn't. And God says, all right, I'll take that bet. And then he makes things go terribly wrong for Job. But you might think that, you know, for God to know that Job is faithful, then has to be put to the test. That's the point. By suffering, faith is displayed and expressed. And you might think faith involves a practical commitment to the value of something else more than your own comfort and well-being. That's what faith is in this context. And that's what Job expresses. So suffering is necessary. Again, you might just say, yeah, it's really important. But unless you're tested, you might think that people don't know. Secular perspective, initiation rites and rituals illustrate that suffering is a test of virtue. And you might think this is the importance of these things. Of initiation rites, hazing rituals, all these kinds of things are vitally important. Why? Because it's important for you to know that other people have certain virtues. How do you know this? You test them. You make them suffer. And if they come through, then they're part of your group. Because you know you can rely upon them in future. You can trust them. You can, you know, show solidarity with them. That's why suffering is important on this social level, as a test for these kinds of virtues. So Jean LaFontaine, book, Mid-80s Initiation. The experience of pain is common in rituals of maturity, often accompanied by the teasing or terrorizing of initiants. The suffering is a necessary part of the ritual, may be seen as a means of transforming the individual or as a test of their fortitude, their strength of character, or of, as both. And it's important for you to know that. It's important for you to know that other people have these virtues, that they're strong, that they won't wilt under pressure, because it's really important for certain groups to know that. So undergoing ordeals expresses and communicates respect for the authority of the group officials. That's one thing that's communicated here. And commitment to and solidarity with the group itself. So the one bit of empirical data. Empirical work indicating that experiencing suffering and hazing rituals increases liking for the group and enhances social cohesion. And partly this is if you suffer, you have to think it's worthwhile. And so you elevate the value of the group you've just suffered to join. You think they better be worthwhile for me to join them after I've undergone this terrible ritual. And so you think they're better, and therefore you think more highly of them. This enhances social cohesion there as well. So there's empirical work demonstrating this, I think, or at least suggesting this. Okay, conclusion. Suffering can be essential for the social virtues of justice, love, and faith, or solidarity. I think the value of suffering along these lines is apparent in both religious contexts and in secular. And indeed, it might be plausible so that forms of suffering are central to the flourishing of social groups. You think a similar story can be told about shame and about guilt and lots of other virtues that have this kind of social dimension, but which necessarily involve suffering. Okay, thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. I think I don't agree in a lot of the things you said, because I work in a practical environment. I've been working with criminal offenders for a long time. And, you know, this is theory about suffering can bring social virtues of justice. When you take criminal offenders first in the jail system, you can have a jail system for three things. For isolation of the subject, society doesn't want them to be close to them. So they pay for what they did, which is mostly what they do. You know, that's what their jails are for. And the good value should be to rehabilitate them and to readapt them. Usually society doesn't care about that. They just care to take them out of the way and punish them. When you talk with the guys who are in jail, they have distorted cognitive schemes, and they feel they are wonderful. If you ask them, are you a good guy or a bad guy? They said, of course I'm a good guy. I said, but you cut people in little pieces, and you punish and you make them suffer. I said, oh, no, no, no. That was my job. I'm a very good person, because if I'm eating a sandwich and you're hungry, I will give you a bite. So I'm a very good person. So when you put them in jail and they suffer because they are isolated and they hold this, that creates more resentment. And more than 60% of the people who are in jail will come back. There's not. And some of them, you know, also interviewed members of the organized crime, and they have this distortion, and they said, you know, and they're in high security jails, and they said, I'm just like in a spa now, in a spa. I'm just like having a diet. They go very fat and they're drunk and they take drugs. But now I'm in a spa. So I lost like 20 kilos and I'm fine. And you are worse outside. They can kill you right away. I'm sick here. And, you know, I'm going to go. I have all these forces and money and I'm going to go. So in short, suffering is not essential for the justice system, or it's not what is happening. That's, there are cognitive distortion that prevents the suffering of the individual. And that's why they are there, most of them.
Lots of nice points there, and lots of things to talk about. A number of things I did say, I had the caveat that possibly most of the ways in which the state imposes hard treatment on criminals is unjustified, and partly unjustified because it doesn't motivate the right kind of reflection, doesn't provide the right kind of conditions for people to acknowledge and repent. And maybe that kind of imprisonment is just the wrong model for hard treatment. It just simply doesn't work for the reasons that you say. Deprived in that way, then it's really easy to blame others rather than blame oneself. So there's no guarantee doing any of this, and I had another line when I said, look, it doesn't necessarily bring about this, and it might not necessarily bring about this in the vast majority of cases, given what the criminal systems are like in very, very many countries. So everything I said in the paper, I think, is compatible with what you were saying there. But you might think that if you are to motivate reform and repentance and acknowledgement, when I think virtues, and I think we all want to do that, but how do you do it? And you do it on this view by communicating to people what they've done, that the state disapproves and condemns them for it, and providing the conditions in which they can acknowledge that. Now, providing the conditions doesn't mean that they will acknowledge that. And in many cases, given the terrible upbringings they've had and the terrible lives, they won't, because they're so far away from an ideal of reflection and acknowledgement that this will never happen without significant investment in the prison system that's probably massively unlikely. Nevertheless, you don't, so that's why I'm saying you don't get these benefits unless you have a system like that in place. So it's a claim of the importance of suffering in these kinds of situations, but it's not a justification of the kind of suffering that's imposed in most countries. And everything I said, I think, is perfectly consistent with what you said about how criminals think about themselves, how they think about their imprisonment, how they think about society in general. They don't acknowledge it, but that just means the system isn't enough and isn't good enough that they're being communicated with in the right kind of way.
I'm just like saying that your point is that suffering, it's good for social virtue, and I'm saying no, that's not the point, because like what? Like you said, you suffer when you have pain, physical pain, or when you have emotional pain, and they don't have nor physical pain nor, and that doesn't bring it just like immediately, just like that. You have to change cognitive distortions, yeah, and it doesn't come with suffering.
That's why I said the kind of hard treatment that might be legitimate to get people to motivate and reflect isn't solitary confinement, isn't 23 hours a day in a cell by yourself. It's maybe this kind of thing where you get the criminal to meet their victim and engage in conversation on numerous occasions. You get them talking to each other. And that is exceptionally, I imagine, difficult for criminals to do. But if they're willing to do that and they come to understand what the nature of their wrongdoing and how much it affected the other person, they start to grasp. That's the kind of hard treatment that might be effective in getting people to reflect. And I think that's a form of imposing hard treatment which would be legitimate in these cases, precisely because it aims at reform and treats them as not as things to be locked away from society because society doesn't like them. You treat them as reflective, rational beings. It's a way of respecting them. And you respect them by giving them the opportunity to do this, rather than forcing them to do this, rather than locking them away. I mean, I think these utilitarian justifications for punishment are just illegitimate. And I think if that's what punishment is, then it can't be legitimate or appropriate. I think the communicative theory is the theory, and you say it's very abstract, and it is very abstract. It's theoretical. It's what has to be true in order for there to be a just, legitimate system of judicial punishment. And maybe no system currently goes anywhere near those conditions. But that something like that has to be true if state imposition of suffering is to be justified. Maybe almost all of it isn't.
Thank you. thanks, Michael. I enjoyed that. But a worry similar to the worry that I had on whenever that was that Monday? It's not identical. But anyway, you claim that suffering imposed and punishment is communicative in the sense that it focuses attention on the wrongdoing on the part of the criminal. The criminal's attention is focused on the wrongdoing, and that might bring about repentance and regret and remorse and so on. And I guess the worry I have is that it does or might very well focus the criminal's attention on the wrongdoing, but the wrong kind of attention, as it were. So the criminal, to the extent that the criminal's attention is apt to be focused on the wrongdoing, is apt to be focused on the wrongdoing as the thing that's caused me now to be in this bloody situation where I'm going through all this suffering. And the sort of related thought is that to the extent that that will prompt regret, it would be the wrong kind of regret. So the criminal will come to regret that he or she did whatever he or she did, but only because it's put them in this bloody awful situation. It won't be the kind of regret that now I really see the meaning of what I did and I wish I hadn't done that, you know, as an end in itself, as it were. Yeah, I wish I hadn't done that because now I'm suffering as a consequence of it. So it's a sort of worry of that kind that I've got.
But where perhaps a parent shouts at a child because they've done something wrong, and by shouting you want to seriously communicate how disappointed and angry you are at what they did. In a way that's conveying and communicating censure and condemnation for it, and you do it in a certain tone of voice, and if you do it with various aims. One is to tell them how important it was that they don't do that again, that you have certain norms and standards and rules, and they're not to violate them. But also by doing it in a particular tone of voice in which you want to perhaps, if not shock, at least make them take it seriously, because you could do it in a really nice tone of voice. You shouldn't do that again. And that might be ineffective for all kinds of reasons, but one of the things that doesn't communicate is how important the norm violation is to you. And it's probably not going to motivate them to reflect on what they did if that's the aim of it. You want to, because you don't want to just force them automatically not to do that in the future, because even young children, I take it, you want to communicate your respect for them and you want them to figure it out. That daddy's very upset now. Why is he upset? I shouldn't do that. And partly it might be I don't want him to shout at me again, but partly is oh maybe that is really wrong. And so that's the kind of thing. So in a way, it's if that's the kind of model for loving parental discipline, you might think the same kind of model applies here. Now, lots of kids shouted at will just hate their parents for it, and will you know, they'll suffer in the wrong kind of way, and just, well, I wish I'd got away with it. I wish I'd not been caught. And that, of course, that happens in lots and lots of judicial contexts. But at least it need not happen. And if you want to communicate seriously how you take the norm violation, and you want to take you want your child to take the message home that they ought to not do that again, and not merely force them, because you regard that they're a human being, then what's wrong with communicating that in a way that you think will upset them? I take it you shout because, one, you're upset, and two, part of communicating things in that voice is you want them to be upset. I take it.
Just very briefly, the reason is not enough in the criminal justice system to, and God knows how this would work, but somehow force criminals each day just to sit down with you and sort of explain to them the wrongness of what they did and the consequences of what they did, is that they won't take it seriously. You somehow need to shock them into taking seriously the content of what you're saying.
Just, I mean, the parallel point with the criminal justice system, if we just got information about bodily damage and didn't hurt it, we'd
often ignore it. Paul Brand's experiments, you know, supposed to suggest that if we have a system indicating bodily damage and it doesn't hurt, we just carry on doing what we're doing. So it's got to hurt. And you might think similarly with guilt. If guilt didn't feel bad, we know we've done something wrong, but I'm going to carry on doing that. So I think it's a similar case. It's a way in which you provide a context for people to reflect, because reflection and acknowledgement of wrongdoing and making reparations and apologies is really tough. So people are inclined not to do that unless you provide motives for them to do that. So that's the kind of line. But of course, the right kind of motives to do that aren't, again.
Well, for me, it's obviously that the punishment is suffering necessary. For definition, if someone enjoys his punishment, it's not punishment. It's a reward, or it's avoid the punishment. But the question is, how can we ensure that the punishment is motivating the criminal and is not a kind of Ludovico technique or therapy of aversion in case of the punishment? And second, could be that the central to flourish the social groups are not the suffering, but the empathy? It means I don't need to see you suffering. It's just I can imagine you suffering, and that flourish the social group. Not necessarily the suffering, indeed.
Good. In response to that, two things. One, I'm entirely in agreement with you. You don't want systems that just force people to reform. And I think that's what's ultimately wrong with utilitarian or consequentialist accounts of punishment. One, they legitimize punishing the innocent. And two, if reform is the only or the prime value, you can do anything to reform people. You can treat them as a means to an end. And that's always been the problem with utilitarianism and consequentialism. If it's the end that's important, then you don't reflect or respect the person. So maybe I'm more of a Kantian on this one. I think ways in which, you know, you have to, if you're in the business of punishing people, you have to punish people in a way that respects their rational autonomy, respects them as people. Utilitarian reformist accounts just simply don't do that. So they've got to be wrong. And I think retributivist accounts that just say giving the criminal what they deserve in some kind of way, that imprisoning them, taking away because you somehow you have some kind of calculus that this is what they deserve for that kind of crime, and that's the only goal. I think they fall short as well. Again, partly because they don't treat the criminal as a person who's capable of reforming themselves. So I'm entirely with you on the first part. On the second part, couldn't we do this by getting the person to empathise with the victim of their crime? I take it that's what conversation's supposed to do. And empathy is really horrible in these circumstances. For you to realise and really empathise with the pain and suffering that that person experienced as a result of what you did, that's got to hurt you. And bringing you to that position is really important. So empathy isn't a kind of warm, loving, caring emotion. It's awful. If you really empathise with something terrible that happened to someone else, then that's a horrible thing to experience. And that would be the kind of idea. So I think empathy can be a form of suffering in this instance as well.
Thank you. Well, this has to do what we were discussing before about the providing the circumstances to acknowledge the wrongdoing. When you acknowledge the wrongdoing, acknowledgement comes from reflection. And we reflect upon certain values. So the values that come to judge certain act as a wrongdoing are a certain specific kind of values, in this case, social values. right? So in order for the sinner to repent, they would have to reflect upon the same values. So the values would have to be there, internalized prior to the implementation of suffering, because otherwise suffering cannot be legitimately imposed, because the conditions that provide the, that make the sinner, the wrongdoer, acknowledge are partly having certain values. So some sort of, I don't know, we would have to provide with some sort of system that makes the criminals, that makes the certain values like available to criminals, and this would be very impulsive in terms of, you know, treating the other as a independent rational being.
No, again, if what was required is that you instill certain social values in the criminal by purely instrumental means and then get them to reflect, that would be illegitimate, and that's not what an appropriate account of punishment, just account of punishment, would support. But there are ways in which you can get people to reflect on core values that I take it they already have, if they're not too psychopathic or they're not too sociopathic. I mean, it could be the case that oftentimes lots of people just don't realize or want to ignore the harm they're doing to other people because it's really difficult, but get them to really reflect on the harm, unless they're so self-centered that they don't realize that harm to others is genuine harm. They don't, you know, they don't think it's real harm at all. And those people, I imagine, are they're out there, but I imagine lots of other criminals are not like that. They ignore something deep down that they know that in that situation they've done something terribly wrong by a value that they endorse themselves. But it's easy to ignore those values. I take it, it'd be really weird to say that everyone is just ultimately, utterly selfish, even though people behave like that an awful lot of the time. Why do people behave like that an awful lot of the time? Because it's easy to ignore the reality of other people and the reality of their lives as well. So when people spend massive amounts of money on luxury items and don't give to people who are genuinely in need, are they utterly, irredeemably selfish? No, they just aren't thinking enough, or they're ignoring because it's easier to ignore the fact that other people's demands on them should outweigh theirs. So I think in lots of cases, the people will, people involved will have shared core values, but they're not reflecting on them, they're not endorsing them, they're just cut off from them. And maybe one of the purposes of hard treatment is to get them to reflect on that value, to get them to, you know, the Kantian idea, to think about how would they like it if that was done to them. Now maybe there's other people who just don't have core social values at all. And in that case, it's going to be very, very difficult to motivate any kind of reflection for the reasons that you rightly point out. But I guess it's what we think about, you know, whether you think people can be reformed and the conditions under which that can be brought about. I'm not getting anything more positive or practical to say about that, but I do think that you can get people to reflect on values that they actually have, but they're not focusing on it at the moment. I think that's true of lots of people when they behave selfishly.
I guess I see what you're saying in very extreme cases, for example, in murder or things like that, but in less severe crimes, for example, stealing, I'm pretty sure it could be the case where someone doesn't really see stealing as something morally wrong, or some other example of not such severe, you know, crimes. So how could you, you know, incorporate all of that, someone that has a completely different set of core values with this idea of reform?
Set of core values. So you might have values that, you know, so there's nothing wrong with tax avoidance or tax dodging. That's the kind of theft that lots of people think, oh, that might be perfectly okay if you get away with it. And then you might draw parallels with other kinds of thieving that they would agree is utterly wrong, and you point out inconsistencies. You can't hold that kind of stealing's wrong and that kind of stealing's okay. So in a way, it's to get them to reflect on why it would be wrong for them to make an exception for themselves in these cases. Again, it's a kind of core Kantian ideal here. But I think, lots of, you know, think of the code that certain mafioso might have. There's codes of honour, there's codes of rules and regulations. You shouldn't violate them. Not the codes of all of those other normal citizens, we reject those. But we have our own codes, and what you try and do is to say, well, their codes are, you know, ought to be ones that, given your core commitments, you're committed to as well. It might be very difficult for them to do that, but it's not. I think trying to put people in a situation where they do reflect and come to that realization under their own steam is the only way to properly treat them as rational, reflective beings, and rather than forcing them to do things, which is not what the state should be in the business of doing, because it's incompatible with regarding someone as a citizen, a genuine, rational citizen who we value as much as we value anyone else. That's what universal respect ought to require. But universal respect ought to require that you censure and condemn people when they violate the rules and regulations that are supposed to govern us all. That would be.
Thank you very much. I was trying to read your conference from my point of view. That's the only way I can do it. And it was very interesting, this idea of suffering as a way of communicating something to the member of society. That was like a big idea that I found interesting, how society in some way creates ways of symbolically or physically tell the individual you're not getting to be part of society somehow. But I have a lot of trouble with this emotional suffering, and not only because of the biological conditions that can trigger not this emotional suffering, but also from a sociologist's point of view. And this is maybe politically incorrect to say it, but there's a book, this author is Beverly Skeggs, and she talks about the relation of self and social class. And she says that this idea of the self as a very reflexive self that gets to remorse and always is valuing things and thinking about them, it's really a self that is Anglo-Saxon, middle class, and that is imposed to other societies and other classes. And maybe, point of view, it's really nice that you see people who have done terrible things as very reflexive and capable people to have guilt and remorse and all this process, because it's a process, a very, it involves a reflexive capability that it's not innate. It's something that you elaborate in the process of a relation with the others. So maybe if you're not, have you not think about that you're trying to impose your own view of how self is, you know, a bias in your...
No, a splendid point. And yeah, I don't want to impose particular ways of thinking and reflection and reasoning that might be prominent in certain cultures and say that they apply to everyone. But I do think there's a sense of reflection and reasoning that is pretty universal, and it's not associated with the kind of armchair reflection and pondering that might be a caricature of certain kind of Kantian moral philosophy. People act for reasons, and people are capable of acting for reasons and believing for reasons, and that's a capacity that human beings have. And what's involved in that? Well, part of what's involved in that is a capacity from stepping back from one's first-order desires and urges and reflecting and saying, should I do this, should I not? And that doesn't require any particular kind of moral philosophical view of what ideal reflection is. It's just something we do as human beings. We act and believe for reasons. And you might think the way in which we think about, we plan, and we plan all the time. That kind of planning doesn't require, everyone plans all the time. We plan what we're going to do this evening. We plan what we're going to do the weekend. We plan what we're going to do in the next 5 minutes. We think about whether we ought to believe who should have voted for in the election. This is something that rational creatures, that, I mean, that's the kind of reasoning and reflection that is just constitutive, I think, of human rationality. And I would think that that's pretty universal. And I certainly wouldn't want to think that I can't think that other people are capable of that. Happened recently in the UK in the Brexit vote in a really interesting way, in a kind of, I think, very dubious way. Part of the reason that the UK voted to leave Europe was because lots of people have been disenfranchised, lots of people, certainly since the crash, but maybe for decades and decades, poor people are getting poorer. That's happening all over the place. And the blame was put on people from certain poor communities in the UK who voted against their interests to leave the European Union, which will be financially disastrous for them because they get lots of support from the European Union. And then people said, well, look, you can't really blame them. And in a way, they don't really know what they're doing. You can't really blame them for that. It's just the social circumstances have made them that way. And that's why you don't blame them for that. You blame, you know, the people who went to Oxford and Cambridge. And I think that is an incredibly dangerous patronising view of the people who voted. They had the information available to them. They're rational, reflective creatures. They could have looked up the information that was available on the internet that everyone else had, and they didn't. And they're blameworthy. They're blameworthy for that. And to say they're blameworthy is a way of respecting them as rational creatures who are able to make their decisions. And I'd hate to be in a position where I don't think other human beings are like that. Or that's a kind of imposition of my sort of imperialist rationale. No. Well, it depends what you mean by reflexive. Reflexive is thinking about what we're going to do. And I think that's something we do all the time. And I think thinking about what we've done is something, you know, we feel guilt, we feel remorse, we feel happiness, we look ahead and with joy and expectation about, you know, Friday and Saturday looking around Mexico City. That's the kind of acting and reflecting for reasons. That doesn't require a particular theory about reflection.
Then you're giving a lot of power to consciousness.
Yeah. Happy to do that. I think that's constitutive of you, because I think if you don't think people are capable of that, you're not treating them as people. I think that's really dangerous, to treat people not as if they're incapable of that, making decisions for themselves. I think that's really, yeah. And I think lots of people in with the Brexit, I think lots of people thought that way. And I thought that's a really worrying trend that's in the UK, that you thinking a big bunch of population can't think for themselves. And I think if you think that about criminals, that's really dangerous as well. They can't come to acknowledge.
I think that would be the way.
Well, you focus a lot of the punishment, but I think that punishment is few effective to social communicate, because we can't in a criminal doesn't think that he act wrong, and no matter the pain that he feels, no change his mind of about the action, and in this case the punishment is few effective, no, because yes. I think that punishment is few effective to social communicate, because we can think about criminals that no matter the pain they feel, and don't change mind, no, about the criminal, about the action. And they believe that the direction was good, and I think the effective for social communicate is the act if they actually feel remorse, repentance, or shame. But not the punishment, no?
Yeah,
I think I wasn't at all clear in the paper or clear enough as to what I think the relation is. I certainly don't want to think the imposition of punishment will always be effective or mostly be effective. It doesn't guarantee that people reflect and repent. In most cases, it might not do that. However, if we are to provide the conditions in which we treat people as rational or just people and respect them, and we want to provide a situation in which they come to acknowledge for themselves what they did wrong, to motivate them to think and reform themselves, apologize and make reparations, then a system of hard treatment is that's the way to do it. So it's the thought that you don't get at the state level repentance, apology, reparation, reform without that. But it's certainly not the claim that whenever you impose punishment, you'll get that. And because I think a lot of the time it doesn't work. But I also think that without putting those conditions in place, it's really easy. It's very easy for people not to acknowledge and reflect at all. So you don't get the repentance and the values that you want without this system in place. Precisely because people won't reflect and acknowledge because it's really difficult to do. It really is when you've done something wrong. It's very, very easy to ignore it if you can. If there's not an emotional backing in the case of individual guilt, it's really easy to think, well, I've not done anything wrong. Or to just ignore it and forget about it and carry on with your business. So it's at the state level that you provide the conditions in which it's not so easy for you to do that. And that's the thought. But it's no. I'm not arguing that any imposition, state imposition of punishment is going to guarantee that. It clearly won't, for all the reasons you rightly point out and other people have rightly pointed out. But that's the thought. And it is, you know, it's not the case that pain will always motivate repair and damage because lots of pain is chronic. But that doesn't mean that you would get the benefits of bodily repair and damage avoidance without pain. So you might think that if you're going to have these really valuable things, you'd better have a pain system. But that doesn't imply whenever you have pain, you bring about valuable goals. So that would be the point.
Thank you. Well, I have enjoyed all the discussion. I think it's very interesting. I was thinking that I agree in what you said about that, and it's a very provocative idea, really, that suffering is necessary, no? Especially nowadays, then, that we tend to think that suffering is always bad. So, but it's difficult also to. It has to be pondered, and I think you have done it very well. But I was thinking some of the mechanisms you said that should be implemented. One could be, because you talked about respect for the other and all these things, and this is related to human rights culture and civic culture. And I think that could be I want to know your opinion, but I think it could be a very useful and necessary mechanism, not only for criminals, but also for society. And indeed, it has been implemented in many ways. For example, even in Latin America, for example, I think in Uruguay, they have reformed the judicial system, and prisons are now trying to implement or to include in the traditional way of punishment view of ¿cómo se dice penas? Sentences and the time they spend in jail. This idea of guaranteeing the rights of the criminals. And this is a very important change because it changes the view that the sin or the wrongdoing is based on the person itself. And instead now the emphasis is on the act of doing wrong. And that's what they are trying to implement through this judicial system. And in Mexico also there is something like that, and in other countries. So I think that could be a very conveying and useful way to do that. But there is a very strong challenge, The other idea is that through civic culture and these human rights, you can also convey this idea of empathy, or promote empathy and acknowledging really what you have done. No? But it's a challenge trying to implement all this in an extended system, judicial system, or no? So what do you think, or what is your position about this?
About which particular aspect of it? About how? Yeah, so I'm not, as is kind of obvious, I'm not that up on the practicalities of the right kind of hard treatment that will be effective in these instances, because it depends upon the crime. So you look at the particularities of the victim, the criminal, their relationship, the particular system in the area or the country. So all of these things will be massively complicated factors. But I do think ways in which conversations between criminal and victim when they're appropriate, I think that's a very positive move, because it's a way in which you get criminals to acknowledge in a way that treats them as part of a communicative process. State communicates with them, they communicate with the victim, and it's a way in which they're part of this discussion. And I do think that is a move in the right direction. I also think that that's a way in which the state communicates to them how much they regard them as still a member of the community and a genuine citizen, where you don't communicate that when you lock people up in solitary confinement for years. Part of the picture is what the state communicates by imposing sentences and hard treatment. And part of it is concern and respect for victims. So imagine someone's a victim of serious wrongdoing and the state doesn't do anything. I mean, that communicates something. It communicates the state doesn't care about you, doesn't care about its citizens, doesn't care about the values that have just been violated. So in a way, having a system of judicial punishment communicates all kinds of things. One is a commitment to these norms and values that we share as citizens of the same country. That's importantly communicated. So I think there's lots of different communicative dimensions here. But in terms of the practicalities, yeah, I don't know enough about it, and that will be up to people who work in the industry to determine what's effective and what's the best way to treat people as genuine persons, and at the same time try and reform them. And in some instances, maybe that's going to be impossible. In which case, you know, it's not the case that the judicial system will be able to do the impossible. Sometimes there's nothing you can do. And that's just a sad fact of life.
Because some of the examples they mentioned before, for example, a psychopath, or even the less the offenders. Like I remember, I taught in a graduate school here in criminology and all the penal sciences, that and the students were people who work in jails, and they told me, as they told you, that when, for example, one said that one thief, when every day when he went out to steal, he took his pistol. He had the Virgin of Guadalupe, Virgin, it was blessed. And then he said to his wife, "I'm going to work," and took the pistol, and he was going to work. So it is true that there is also very challenging problems in the impairments, in cognitive things. And I agree that culture is very important. It can convey a lot, but it's very difficult to try to, in a large scale, to make different treatments for psychopaths and less offenders. But I think I agree with you in that repentant and suffering could be is necessary in a certain way also.
Which is why if a state wants to achieve these extremely valuable goals, then you need massive investment in the probationary system, the prison system, judicial system, massive investment, and that's difficult to sell, because lots of people are not sympathetic to the idea. If you're going to spend money anyway, it's not going to be on those people. So it's really difficult for any political system to say that should be where the money goes. But if you're serious about these values, of communication and censure and condemnation reform, yeah, you're going to have to invest massively. And since people don't seem to, then the problem's getting worse, and you don't get people reforming, you don't get apologies and reparations, and you get increased recidivism and criminality. That's just a problem. And nothing I say there. This is a kind of ideal level, but it's just like, if there is to be a just system of state punishment, it's going to, I think, look like something like that, but in an ideal.
Thank you very much for that talk. So I'm not sure I'm going to articulate this in a way that makes total sense, but here are my thoughts. So maybe something went wrong with the empathy process so that the subject committed a crime. And one of these things that could have gone wrong is that the subject doesn't have that particular suffering in his repertoire. And so that's one possibility. The other would be probably that he just doesn't care. And the other one would be that he probably cannot relate that suffering to his own. So in the first case, if I'm understanding you correctly, could be that by inferring suffering in the wrongdoer, you would give him that or her that particular suffering to his repertoire so that he could feel empathy somehow. In the second case, I just think it is very complex because it depends on many, many different social and cognitive problems. And in the third case, in which he cannot relate his suffering to the suffering the other is doing, I don't know how can it be connected. So those are just general thoughts that I have.
Thanks. No, a very nice point. I think in certain cases, when you might think there's nothing much to be done, besides maybe because the person is in such a state that no amount of reflection and reform is going to do anything, then what does the state do? Well, I think incarceration to protect other citizens communicates also concern for them. So in a way, you might think then the reformist element's gone out of the window. If reform's impossible, then don't aim at reform. It's pointless. And then you might think that some instrumental reasons and some utilitarian considerations come into play. You can be a Kantian and still think consequences matter. And the consequences of this person still being free in order to commit further crimes would reflect a lack of concern at the state level for its other citizens. So maybe incarceration in that case will be something like very, very non-ideal way of protecting the populace. And so that could be a part of the judicial system as well. Sometimes you just have to do that. Sometimes to do things that you might think are otherwise unjustifiable, but the consequences merit it in those cases. But then you might think that person falls a long way short of the kind of rationality that is constitutive of human beings, and they need to be treated as a means because they're not capable of being treated as an end. I think someone might say that, and that's true of young children. It's true when you don't give even older children the right to vote, because you might think they're not fully autonomous creatures, and therefore children don't have rights that adults have, and doesn't mean they have no rights. But you might think what's justified in the case of a child wouldn't be justified in the case of an adult. Maybe it's going to be like that. So it's a way in which you have rules and regulations dealing with people who aren't fully autonomous, or autonomous in the right kind of way, or not developed enough. So I think that would be what you do in that kind of case. So you supplement the kind of communicative ideals with just a recognition of the importance to protect other citizens from a wrongdoer. I think that would be.
I think as time is pretty much up, and I will allow myself as a moderator to make a common question. I very much liked your talk, and I found it refreshingly countercurrent and in line with some that I suspect are anthropological invariants in most cultures. And so that's why is that so? It's very interesting. But I like, especially in this last slide, that from an empirical scientist, you can make predictions. And you can test them. So there's a couple of predictions here. Suffering can be essential for social virtues of justice, love, faith, and solidarity. And you can check different societies if they are practicing these or not, and if they, you find the results. And here, suppose that forms of suffering are central to the flourishing social groups in general. So are we becoming less successful as a society because we are abandoning these practices? I think that's a prediction which very much could be tested.
It would be fascinating to see what happens, and you know, I don't know the anthropology or sociology or anything like that, but I imagine in certain very you might think of the virtues as ways in which we deal with universal human problems, universal. So everyone loses people they love or they're close to, and you might think grief is a kind of universal emotion. There, everyone faces some threats and danger, and fear does that. And you might think, well, for social groupings, are certain things really, really essential for the functioning of the social group? If you have some system of laws or norms, then there might be some form of negative emotion that is needed in order to protect those norms. Maybe shame functions as signaling to others that you violated social norms, and by lowering yourself, you want to be brought back into the group. So no, but it'd be interesting to see. I've got nothing to say about that, apart from just a very philosophical intuition, which we're always criticised for, that I suspect you're going to need something like this in most groups. And the more successful ones, maybe the ones that embody more of the social virtues. I think that would be my intuition.